You're listening to the Cricket Podcast.
I think it was a disgraceful performance, and I think it should never be permitted to happen again.
That is very good.
I'm good. I'm very tired, Ross, because I've just got back from my third stag do in the space of 4 weekends. So I'm a broken man, but, you know, buoyed by the UK's stunning showing in the Eurovision Song Contest yesterday. So, you know, that perked the spirits up. How are you?
All right. Well, the issue we've typically got is that we've now been doing this podcast for, well, we've been podcasting for, what, 5 years, maybe, I reckon? Mm. And Jack is so cheap when it comes to sorting out the way in which we do the streaming that we still use rubbish software, and we still don't know actually how to use each of the individual bits, which is increasingly frustrating, I suppose. But that's just life, isn't it? That is just life. Anyway, we're here to talk about cricket. The big thing about cricket at the moment is that the IPL is obviously in full flow. It's coming to a very, what's the word? It's coming to the end. It's coming to the climax. Every
it's
game,
to a sort of conclusion.
Yeah, every game is important. Everyone is seemingly increasingly excited, but okay, some of the games are just a bit dull, Max. They're a bit dull.
Yes, it makes our lives a little harder trying to find some narratives and things like that.
Anyway, we're here to talk about.
I think maybe we were spoiled at the start. In fairness, with some of the goods we got given, Tuatia just single-handedly doing ridiculous things. You know, there was the finish with the overthrow and the 2 sixes off the final balls. I mean, even the first game between Punjab and RCB, there was Odin Smith spanking the ball into distant quarters. So maybe this is the, as we like to say, the reversion to the mean.
Yeah, I suppose it might be. Max, before we get into it, we are sponsored by Serious Cricket. Go onto the website, use code TCP22 for 10% off. Also, we are on Twitter and Instagram at The Cricket Pod, and you can also get more up close and personal with the podcast and your fellow cricketing community by signing up for our Patreon, which is patreon.com/thecricketpod, and it's only, what, £5 a month, £4 a month? Go and do it. It's been absolutely great to watch the IPL with everyone, and we're also, there's so much cricket. This English summer is just starting. Max, you've not played too much cricket, really, have you, this year? What is it one outing you've had so far?
Yeah, just the one outing for the I Don't Like Cricket Club, but it was a successful one. We won the game. I will be turning out on Saturday for my normal club, so that'll be my first game of the season. They've won 2 in my absence, so it's all good.
Well, let's get right to it then, Max, because the first game we're going to cover is the one that is just finished, and it was my boys, the Royals. I'm wearing the wonderful pink hat, and this was an important game. It had some significance. If the Royals were going to lose, it kind of opened up everything else to them potentially slipping out of the back door. And they've lost one of their best players. They've lost their finisher. Shimron Hetmyer has been absent for the last couple of games and was absent again today, although he's back in India and quarantining because of the birth of his offspring. Max, it's a huge blow to lose someone like that, but today Jimmy Neesham came back into the side. Not a like-for-like replacement, but again, they had a bit more of a balance. Lucknow, on the other hand, they were going pretty much all guns blazing. They realised that they accidentally picked Karan Sharma in the last game, and Ravi Bishnoi was... maybe they just left Ravi Bishnoi like at the hotel or something. They got on the wrong bus or something like that. Don't know what happened there. But he was back in the side. And the scaly boys in their fish-like outfit.
The tuna pyjamas.
Yeah, exactly that. They were in a good position. They're fighting out for the first and second position with Ahmeda Bad Boys. Ahmeda Bad Boys had put on the pressure by beating CSK earlier, which we'll come on to. But this should have been a Royal Rumble, I thought, Max.
I think the Royal Rumble is designated only for the Royals against the Royal Challengers Bangalore. That's the true Royal Rumble in the literary sense. But yeah, second versus third. One team looking to cement their place in the eliminator, is that not the eliminator, the other one,
the one
where you get the second chance. And for the Royals, it was equally important to not get dragged down into that kind of fight for an actual playoff spot, even though they're in a good position. They were running a risk if they lost their two games. So probably the most important of the games this weekend, that's fair to say. And it probably delivered a bit more than the others, but that's not necessarily giving it a huge amount of credit. You pointed out earlier that the Rajasthan Royals four opener plan seemed to work quite nicely today.
Yeah,
which it hadn't necessarily done before, but we saw Padakal go out from the start, which I think really made the difference, bearing in mind they couldn't quite, like you said, without Hetmyer, couldn't quite build on the start that they'd given themselves, and it ended up being a bit of a meek finish until Trent Bolt went and caused hysterics amongst the guys on the bench with his hitting ability, converted to a true number eight today. But yeah, it was a weird one, wasn't it? Because it was sort of if you'd said to Rajasthan Royals, you can have 178 at the start, they'd have probably been like, yeah. I'll take that.
Well, it's interesting because the Brabourne Stadium, like, there's been loads of runs hit there. Big runs have been hit. It's a great place to play cricket. Great place to bat. So I thought, again, like, with this lineup, if Quinton de Kock or Luckner or KL Rahul gets in, they're in danger, right? But before we get into their innings, I thought, actually, yeah, the four over man, like, Butler's fizzled out a little bit. Yeah, Butler obviously had a great run. Fizzled out a little bit. But that happens in T20, right? There's such high variance. Next game could well hit a century, who knows. But here, Jaiswal back in the side, Devdutt Padakal, again, both of them finding form at the right time. Especially when you've got the likes of Hetmyer kind of sitting on the bench and sitting in quarantine, and Rassie van der Dussen is your other option, which nobody wants in T20 cricket. And I thought today they managed to get to a score which they could bowl to. Like, they are, both teams have a good bowling lineup. Lucknow were really weird in terms of how they used their resources. They are a team of all-rounders, and there was eight bowlers used today by KL Rahul.
You love to see it.
But what was weird, and I think
flexibility, Ross.
What's weird has been pointed out in the chat is that Avesh Khan is probably their best bowlers, and he's only come away with bowling three overs. You're a little bit just like, it's a waste that you're kind of sitting there going, did Marcus Stoinis really need to bowl that over? Probably not. Should have been Avesh Khan. But I was a Royals fan, buzzing that was the case. And when we kind of came out to bowl, Trent Bolt wins you games. Like, Trent Bolt, it wins you one, like, a couple of games a season. We know that when the ball is swinging in those first couple of overs, he is so, so dangerous. And people just need to realise you can't play across your pads when you're playing against Trent Bolt when he's in that kind of mood, right? He managed to dismiss Quinton de Kock, who threw away his wicket. But then Bodoni, next ball, did what you shouldn't have done. Literally played around that front pad, planted his foot, and then did a Shane Watson-esque review.
I can't believe he reviewed that. I can't believe KL Rahul let him review it as well. He went over asking, so can I please, sir? He should just be like, no, get off.
Yeah. It was very, I think on the commentary they sort of referred to it as like a sympathy one, and it was just like, yeah, God, like, mate, let's just prove this out.
Let's see how out you really were.
Yeah. But this is the issue with the Lucknow side, that if Quinton de Kock and KL Rahul, who are both pretty bloody good players, especially in the IPL, if they don't strike, if they don't hit those runs, then it's always going to be a bit of a challenge, no matter how informed Deepak Hooda is. You've then got a bunch of all-rounders who they are decent, but they are decent when they've got a bit of a platform to work with. They're not decent to kind of chase everything down, and when they don't have the people who have taken advantage of the power play, and they really, really struggled today. And Rajasthan Royals, I think, got their game plan spot on in the opening segment of them when they were bowling.
What, bold Trent Bolton? Hope he's really good.
It's a pretty strong
plan. I'd do it. I'm a fan. Yeah, Deepak Hooda's had a good year. I think we should credit him with that. He's had a pretty good season, but it was just a case of too much left to do, wasn't it, between him and Crunel, and then you were hoping, well, you weren't, but one would, for the spectacle of a game cricket, might be hoping that Stoinis could come in and take them a bit further as well. But it was just a case of, you know, you hate to say it and you hate to bang on about it, but at one point, what was it, 4 off 16?
Yeah, they hit a six on KKR, or the ball eater.
Got hit a six and then promptly was out after that. And with that power play of 20, what was it, 20? They were 23 off five overs, weren't they? That instantly took a manageable chase up to 10 and over off 15 overs, which is going to be tough.
Yeah, when KKR Rahul got out, they were 29 for three after 5.3 overs. And that instantly puts you under quite a lot of pressure. And the Brabourne, as we said, great place to bat, but actually even when you're kind of behind the run rate, it becomes a bit of an issue. And they didn't have the stocks today to do it. Again, they did this weird thing where they moved Bodoni around. Bodoni hadn't been quite firing kind of in that five role, so they moved him up to three, whereas Deepak Hooda had been in that role doing really well. Didn't make any difference to Deepak Hooda's day, but Bodoni, obviously that first baller. And it's just weird how teams start, they've got a winning formula. It doesn't matter if one player's not hit a couple of runs for a few games, just continue to trust the process, I suppose. I'm going to channel my inner Mahindra Singh Dhoni.
It's just sort of tinkering doesn't make sense to me. That's the thing. Like, there's no, if you're going to make a change, there should be some like defined benefit to it. You should be trying to make the most of some potential improvement, and I don't see what making Ayush Bodoni, don't see what you get from making Ayush Bodoni go and bat in more difficult conditions than he's been facing for the entire year, with one of the best power play bowlers in the IPL and a ball that's swinging in a power play that, you know, showed that it could be a bit of a tricky phase in this game. And it was swinging heavily. It was a classic left armer's wicket to the right hander. It was a nice picturesque wicket, but it was tough on the poor boy, I thought, to saddle him with that responsibility. But maybe they were trying to protect Deepak Hooda for the same reasons. I don't know.
Well, I think again the bowling lineup today, I thought, was good from Redstone Royals. They got things right. Krishna had a good time with the ball, and I think Sanju Sampson's decision making, actually, I think he got it spot on when he bowled Krishna. He bowled three overs of him early up, and that kind of risks kind of being at the death, but him giving him that over managed to actually get the wicket of KKR Rahul. And if you get KKR Rahul and you get Quinton de Kock, as you say, I mean, even if you take three wickets in the power play, typically you win. Like the odds are definitely in your favour. But two people who kind of went maybe not under the radar, but Ashwin bowled really well today. Ashwin was part of a comedy run out between him and Nishan, where Nishan just decided, it's hit and run, so I'm just going to run and try and get myself.
Yeah, well, I'm afraid I'm fully with Jimmy Nishan on this one. There was probably a run there anyway, and like, you might as well, you know, how many balls were there left? Get the guy on strike who's in the team to be a finisher. Mm-hmm. Maybe Ravi Ashwin's sojourns up to number three have got to his head a little bit.
Maybe.
He was quite reluctant to fall on his sword, wasn't he?
He was. But with the ball today, like the pairing of him and Chahal didn't have the best of games, but Ashwin did. And that's the thing, you bowl in partnerships, and in this team, they bowl together, and that's what works out, right? And they've done really well to actually balance when they're bowling their overs. They know they're always going to have those eight pretty decent overs, and if one of them doesn't do so well, the other one can actually balance it up. And if they both have a good day, which actually has happened quite often in this tournament, it's a bloody great combination. And then Obid Bakoy cramping after three overs and just about gets through his four, but again comes out of it, had a game plan, bowl a load of slower balls, bowl into the pitch, and actually it worked out really nicely for him. I thought it was a really clinical win, Max. Like, this was a well-managed 1-0 victory, kind of.
Yeah, with the goalkeeper going down with cramp in the 89th minute, which I think you would have seen in the FA Cup final if you were watching. But no, you're right. I think it was a statement as much as anything from Rajasthan Royals, given you know, the four teams that are likely to be in the playoffs. They may well be facing up against LSG in a knockout game, and to have beaten them recently and to do so quite comfortably will be really good for them on the mental side of things. It'll be a really positive way to head into the playoffs and gives them a chance now of second place as well, which is as we have discussed in the past, is a massive advantage.
Huge, absolutely huge, and up the Royals, as we're going to say. Max, the second game today saw your beloved CSK play.
Well, plays a bit generous.
So I saw on Twitter that I think this might have, so you get is it 90 crore? You get 90 crore to build a team. I think it is out of the whole auction. So your purse is 90 crore. I think it is.
Okay.
Today I think they were playing a team worth 34 crore.
Yeah.
Which says all you need.
Well, I think I said in the preview show. I think they had eight. They've got eight players in their squad that cost 20 lakh, which is more obviously than everyone else. And I mean, obviously they're out, so why not play the kids?
Yeah, I know. But again, it's good to see people get the opportunity. CSK were pretty much playing a B team and kind of trying to prepare for next season after they've lost this season. Ahmed and Bad Boys were in that position of going, we need to finish first, we want to finish first, or definitely guarantee ourselves in the top two. And they played like it. I thought they actually really impressed, I thought. CSK couldn't really bat. The pitch, it wasn't a belter. But it wasn't by any means a dreadful wicket. It was just dreadful to watch. there was next to no intent from the CSK team. I think you might have pointed out in the group chat.
They didn't score a boundary in the final five overs.
Yeah, didn't score a boundary in the final five overs. So that's probably the worst death period of all time.
It was CSK's second worst. Death batting performance ever.
That is dreadful. And I think they only hit six boundaries after the power play.
Yeah. I think it was five in the power play and six afterwards.
If you're a CSK fan, you're going, what the hell? Like, what are we even bothering watching this for? I was sitting there watching it, and I was like, why am I sitting here putting myself through this? But there's some positive things to take away. Mohammed Shami again bowling well, getting the wicket of Devon Conway out early. Gaikwad. A very weird innings from him. Kind of almost didn't know whether to come or go. Gets a half century, gets me those bonus points from the fantasy team, which is great. So I've regained top spot.
How's it going, by the way?
It's me and Swami. It's kind of going, we're doing alternate places at the moment. But Asai Kishore really impressed me today, Max. Everyone's been talking about Hardik Pandya's captaincy. I think he made an error bowling Rashid Khan in the sixth over when Moeen Ali's in. But here he was just like, you know what, we're going to back Sai Kishore to bowl at Moeen. And actually, Moeen has got a fantastic record against spin. Any type of spin bowling, Moeen's record is brilliant. He's devastating against it. But here, Sai Kishore, who inexperienced in the IPL, we've probably got to say that, were bowled with guile. He was mixing his pace up, he was mixing his length up, he was kind of trying to vary it as well, and really trying to change the angle against Moeen. And I thought it was genuinely really interesting to watch. And if you watch just his deliveries in those overs, he's clearly got a plan. They've clearly gone, right, we need to try and do something here that actually disrupts what Moeen's about. And they're making him, they ended up throwing away his wicket. And Sai Kishore, that's a real collector's item, I think. And very, very impressive from the young man.
Yeah, well, he had a bit of a point to prove as well, because he was on CSK's books for 3 years, I think, and never really got a game, despite having a really good record in the SMAT. I'm just looking now, his T20 economy is 5.5. Right, that's mad. That's so good to have not had a go for CSK given the cost of the team they put out today. So for him to be facing off against them and try getting to prove his worth would have been a nice moment for him. And I think there might have been a bit of a trap set for Moeen. You know, he likes a slog sweep, and it was a sort of a high risk, high reward kind of approach, wasn't it? As in, you know, if you are going to slog sweep, you kind of have to hit it flat, so you are always in danger of picking a man out, and that is what happened in the end. That that Rashid Khan over was interesting. I read a stat on Rashid Khan bowling in the power play of 18 bowlers in the IPL to have bowled in the power play 20 times. Mm-hmm. Spinners, this is. He goes for sixes more regularly than anyone else. I think it's once in every 12.9 balls.
Wow.
So the stats suggest it's not the right move. They maybe would have been better off going with Sai Kishore in the power play rather than Rashid Khan. But
I just didn't think they needed to mind, do it.
No, I don't. Right. But I don't mind the sort of the thinking behind it. Right, try and mix things up. Try and go for an attacking move. But it does seem to be it's a bit weird doing it with your banker spinner. You know, Glenn Maxwell opens the bowling for RCB so often, and he's very effective at it. Rashid Khan, I guess, you know, part of it is bowling him at Moeen Ali, who's really good at playing spin, but also just sort of, I think there's a kind of mental side of facing Rashid Khan, in that people are scared to go after him because of people out on the boundary, and you're in so much danger of getting caught. Mm-hmm. There's only two people out. It takes a lot of that fear away.
Yeah, and if the logic didn't make sense to you, because Moeen Ali, as much as Moeen Ali has a good reputation against spin bowling, he's also got a bit of a worse reputation against proper pace bowling. Alzari Joseph has been no slouch in this IPL, and could have easily slotted into that over there. He bowled only three, could have bowled that one. I think they got it wrong. If they did lose the game, we could be coming back to kind of talking about that over, but it didn't really make a difference.
Never
right?
in danger, was it?
It didn't make a difference. We're kind of trying to pick a hole in something that probably doesn't need to be picked, I guess.
Well, you got to do something.
We do. Let's talk about Ahmedabad boys batting. Ridham and Sahar was a last minute addition to my fantasy team.
Oh really? Well,
and done. Just a gut feel that he was going to have a good day, and he did. He was calm at the crease. He got a bit lucky early on, but that is what T20 cricket's around, right? And then when it comes to it's kind of interesting things that actually happened in that. It's difficult to find them. Like Gill, it was all really pedestrian. Chasing 130 is never going to be.
It was just really well managed. I think that's the case. Like, you can say we can sit here and say, as we do sometimes, that they should have done it quicker to try and up the net run rate, but they don't need to, because all they need to do is win, and they're guaranteed a top two spot. There's no point in risking it. There's no point in risking falling out of the top two by doing anything stupid. And Ridham and Sahar in the power play had, you know, taken the game by the scruff of the neck, got the required rate to below a run a ball. And at that point, it was, I think that's what he said himself after the game. Just get a good start and basically walk it. For the rest, zero risk cricket. And especially when, you look at the CSK bowling lineup, on paper, you wouldn't find anything there to be too worried about. But I think the main talking point from this game probably would be the CSK bowling lineup, wouldn't it?
Well, one man in particular, so Patharana, who came in, Sri Lanka. I think he's played an IPL domestic game, or an IPL game before he's played a domestic game in Sri Lanka. I think there's a weird kind of thing.
Okay. Where
he's, in that competition, which shows that the level of scouting, right, that actually ends up happening in the IPL now. But this guy bowls like Malinga. So if you've not seen it, if you missed the game today, go and watch the highlights. He bowls almost at a lower arm trajectory than Malinga did.
I think it's Rian Parag.
But he was good. He took a wicket with his first ball. Again, when you're so used to kind of the upright kind of movement, actually, it's quite nice to kind of see it. And I think Chowdhury's been good. Super Jet, as I'm calling Sirajit, who comes in, and they're both bowled pretty well, but they are they're kind of conventional, right? You're looking at where the ball could be coming out from. With a Malinga action, as we see, it is difficult to pick up the kind of lower levels of bounce, etc. And also rolling your fingers across it is actually a little bit more difficult to pick up. And he picked up a couple of wickets here today. And hopefully he plays a little bit more. I think they've got one game left now, CSK. Hopefully we see him play again.
That's against RCB, I think.
Because he's interesting, right? He's a really interesting proposition. So hopefully we get to see a little bit more of him.
Yeah. Another one to add to the list of exciting young talent that's been unearthed potentially in this edition of the IPL.
There was chat earlier in the Discord around an under 23s IPL. My view on it, I didn't put my view in at the time, is that I'd prefer not to have something like that. I'd quite enjoy when you've got the doubled brevises, you've got coming into the tournament, and you're just like, I have no idea how this is going to go. And I think them being put in the hot potato kind of mixer that is the IPL, the cauldron, is actually really exciting to see, because you see what people are really made of, right? That's what this is all about. It's about going rags to riches and doing everything else in between. And what about you?
The IPL is getting longer and longer. We don't need a kid's version. That's fine. They've proven that they can hold their own. I think it's all good.
Well, that pretty much leaves. Well, that's today's games wrapped up, Max. It leaves obviously Ahmedabad in a really nice position, or Gujarat Titans in a really good position. They're on 20 points, pretty much guaranteed top two now. For CSK, it was the fat lady had already sung plenty of times, so it was already over for them. Let's take a little bit of a break, Max, with a question from Sudeep, who we can come on to in a minute around the bet, is that he's got a question for us, Max. Who is the best cricket player, Max, Ross or Jack? It's a tough one. That is a tough one.
Yeah. Who's gonna step up with the navel gazing?
Well, I don't know.
I think this is a good question to ask without Jack here.
Yeah, it is a good question to ask Jack. So Jack is not on the podcast because he's been at a music festival the last couple of days and is far too hungover to be anywhere near a computer. So he let the team down. I'm trying to think of how we could do this. We could share the statistics, but Max, you've not played an awful lot for IDLCC.
Yeah.
You're a wicketkeeper, opening batsman, for those who want to know him. I'm like Baba Indranath. I do a bit of everything. I bat, bowl,
box office.
That's how you can do it. And then Jack bowls leg spin and bats himself at number seven in that lower order
role. Because he wants to win the game.
Yeah, he likes the glory.
He likes A, scoring the winning runs, and B, finishing not out for his average.
He is a stat padder.
Someone in the chat earlier was asking for some, well, was saying that we were lacking cynicism and vanity because Jack wasn't here, which I thought was an absolutely wonderful comment. So I thought I'll bring a bit of cynicism. That's
nice.
The captain. I think bats himself for personal gain.
Yeah, not team benefit. He's very selfish. So I reckon let's rate Jack the worst. I think that's completely
well. He's not here, is he? He can't defend himself. I'm on board.
And then let's put us both joint first.
Yeah, I mean, I'd probably have you as the most naturally gifted. I certainly haven't got the guts to step across my stumps and try and hoik the ball over cow corner every single delivery. And you're quite effective at that, it has to be said. And I've not seen you keep wicket because obviously when I'm there, I'm doing it. But from what I can tell, all the feedback, all the secondary feedback that I get is that Ross is a dab hand at it himself. He's just a natural sportsman.
More luck than judgment, Max. More luck than judgment. And I think anyone who's a left-handed opening batsman is always going to have big flair and culture points straight in.
And also a few more dodgy OEWs than others.
We've just had another. So Sudeep, thanks for that super chat. And we've had another one from Jitter. Satisfied Rajasthan Royals fan here in Washington, D.C. Best possible win full of unlikely heroes. I think that's a fair statement, actually. Yeah, you didn't see Josh Butler step up today. You saw Jaiswal and Devdutt Padukal step up. And he finishes off saying, although King Legend did his part to be the cred ball eater of the season.
I think we need a new new sponsor for that.
Yeah, we definitely do. Hope to make a big contribution on finals day. Yeah, love it. It's an interesting one, right, when it comes to some of the play today. Like, I love the IPL. Because it's only 14 games in a season, then the high variance, everyone has that opportunity, right? There's always that bit where you can come out of this season. Even Rian Parag has had one of those games, in this season where you're just like, oh, he's justified why he's in this team. He also has taken the most catches for an outfield player. Do you know that, Max, in the IPL so far?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I think he's got 13, and next is Tilak Varma with 9. So, all round kind of an interesting day's play on that front. Max, we should talk about yesterday, because There's if I had a load of dollar bills in my hand, I would flick them up in the air because
you're printing money.
Yeah, because Sunrisers, we had two bets for our listeners to remind them. We had two bets on. So there was one bet with Sudeep around if Sunrisers were to qualify for the playoffs, then I would have to eat my own words of saying that Sunrisers were terrible and have to buy myself a Sunrisers hat and wear it for the rest of the year on the show. And then another one of our listeners matched that bet but said I'd have to wear a jersey. And I was just like, do you know what? Let's do it. Let's double down. And I made this bet after they'd won five in a row. So they'd won, I think they'd won seven tosses or loaded tosses in a row. They'd won five in a row, and I stuck to the guns. As a podcast, we rallied round and we said no.
We doubled down on the anti-Sunrisers sentiment,
And we've come out of it smelling like roses because yesterday KKR decided to pick a relatively normal lineup for them. They were just like, oh, we are a T20 cricket team and we do have some players who can play T20 cricket, and we're going to try and give Dre Russ about 100 runs, kind of foundation to kind of so we can work with it. And that turned out to be a pretty good way of playing cricket, Max. Like they won easily against Sunrisers.
It's amazing what you can do when you do the right thing, isn't it? they were back to early season KKR, which looked like it might be quite a successful outfit. They got a couple of wins on the two of their first three they won, I think. Narayan and Chakravarti were bowling well. They had Andre Russell firing and they were making the most of it, and they looked like they were a half decent side. And then the wheels came off. They started just like randomly picking teams out of a hat and God knows what else. But they came back to it just when we needed them to most, just to put the nail in the coffin of the Sunrisers. And I was fairly impressed with their performance, particularly Andre Russell had a pretty good day, didn't he?
Yeah, and then the weird thing is that it's not a rare occasion. Like, it's not one of those things. Like, this guy just delivers. Like, it should be called he's just so consistent, and here was no difference. To 49 of 28 balls. It was the first Sunrisers game of the season. I'd not picked Umran Malik in my fantasy team. He took 3 for 33.
I suppose if we're going to give some credit to making the right decision, Sunrisers lost horribly, but they at least went back to using him properly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought so. And again, just some people like let you down. Washington Sundar is a very limited bowler. Like very limited, and when you're not going to try and sneak in different overs, etc., he can be cannon fodder, old Washington Sundar.
Did he bowl the last over?
I can't remember.
I think I remember him serving up a platter of canapes and pie in the shape of full tosses to Andre Russell right at the end. So, not his best day. It's good for them to have him back, though, meaning they don't have to bowl four overs of Aidan Markram, which it's not an ideal position, let's be honest.
No.
It's better than bowling Glenn Phillips, but it's not top of the list of frontline spinners. So, yeah, it wasn't a great day for Washington Sundar. He's decent. He can do a pretty good job. He's just not quite got the flair of some of the spinners in the IPL. But
yeah, and what I'm glad of for for KKR is that they've stopped trying to use Sunil Narine as a floater. Like, the guy just can't do it anymore. He's remodeled his bowling action. The bowling's great. Just let him be a bowler. And if he has a couple of balls at the end, use him in that space. But I'm glad he's not being run out without facing when he's opening up the batting. That was a nice change. Abhishek Sharma continues to impress, actually, for Sunrisers. As much as we chastise them for being a terrible cricket team led by the worst captain and worst IPL player of all time in Kane Williamson with his record this season, Abhishek has come out actually with a clear he's got a clear role definition, knows what his game's about, offers a little bit with the ball as well, but he tries to make the most out of the power play, and actually when you're going out and striking over 150s and being kind of pretty much the single good thing that's happened in this game for Sunrisers, other than Umran Malik taking three for, it's quite nice to see something going right for them.
Yes, he's got his work cut out, hasn't he? He has to score at about 250 to get to a decent power play strike rate and net with Kane Williamson. 9 or 17, like, he's taken ball eating to new heights this year, Kane Williamson. I don't know what on earth is wrong with him. Like, he's never been swashbuckling. He's never going to go out there and score 60 off 20, whatever it was that Bairstow did the other day. But you can usually rely on him to at least score off most deliveries, right? I don't know the stats off the top of my head, but the impression you get from Kane Williamson is that he's a low dot ball percentage but low boundary percentage kind of guy. But at the moment, he's high dot ball percentage, low boundary percentage, which is it's shit, isn't it? He's been killing his team. It's been leaving too much for everyone else to do around him, and in a chase of 170 odd, it's disgraceful. He won the toss again, though, didn't he?
What are you doing with
these coins?
Just because he's a great tosser doesn't mean he's a great cricketer, is it? So that's the issue. And as Ricken said, at least Kohli gets out for ducks, unlike Kane. That is very, very true, right? So the detriment to having to watch this is very, very difficult.
And an excellent catch by Shashank Singh on the boundary as well in this game. I think we neglected to mention earlier in the Rajasthan summary, the relay catch between Butler and Parag, which was... It's probably because they're 10 a penny these days, aren't they? They just happen all the time. You're like, oh, yeah, no, that was good. You're supposed to do that now.
Well, that's what happened. We literally saw a relay catch in our amateur cricket. That's the first game of the season. We saw a relay catch, and everyone was like, it's finally filtered all the way down. Now people are doing it at this level. It's second nature, not even impressive anymore, Max. let's talk about tomorrow's game. But before we do, there was some obviously really sad news this morning, waking up. Andrew Symonds has unfortunately passed away after being in a single vehicle car accident. And I'm sure my reaction of shock was similar to many across the world this morning. Kind of waking up and hearing any news like that is horrendous. The fact that it was with Shane Warne, weeks ago, it was devastating enough for people who were like cricketing icons when we were growing up. You're very familiar with these people. And I don't know what it is, but my next move might have been very similar to other people as well. But it was to load up YouTube and start watching compilation videos of Andrew Symonds just be good at cricket. And the guy is ridiculous. He's fierce is probably the word I would use to describe him, Max. Like an all-round brute who many people pointed out today, he would have been one hell of an IP, like a T20 player. If he was coming through the ranks now... And not
well, he did play a bit, didn't he? He played for Deccan Chargers, Mumbai Indians for a spell, he had a pretty good T20 record. I think he struck at about 150 and averaged 30 odd, I think. Yeah. And that's at the early days of T20, where, you know, like 150 is probably like 160 now. I mean, that's just how far ahead of the game he was in that. And if we had him around now in T20 cricket, he would be immense. Because again, he did everything.
Yeah, and hit the ball bloody hard.
Phenomenal fielder. He could bowl. He had useful bowling. He was a canny bowler, and obviously the ridiculous strength of the batting that he had, he would be going for big bucks.
Yeah, let's see. You said that he has a decent enough record in the IPL. Did he get in the chat? They said he got a century.
Yeah, he did.
But like if he was coming through now and he was playing week in week out, the guy would be, you know, like in the Dre Russ category. I've got no doubt about it. In the Dre Russ, the guy bowled a bit of off spin, but also bowled equally good medium pace. Which is a great asset to have. Just ask Ollie Robinson in England's Test team, and then as you said, like a brute with the bat, and also technically brilliant. Like he averaged over 40 in Test match cricket. Like that is
That's it. People talk about how he wasn't. You know, he's not known for playing Tests. People are like, well, it wasn't really his strength, and he still played a good number of games for Australia, averaging 40, which is like that makes you good. That makes you quite good. Yeah. You know, he's putting to the sword enough times as well. I think it was 150 on a Boxing Day Ashes test and five wickets. So, yeah, more punishment. And he bucked the trend as well, didn't he? He bucked the trend of people being born in Australia and South Africa and England poaching them. He was born in
Birmingham,
went away and played for Australia despite England's best efforts to lure him in.
Yeah, and I think it's not to be said, like, he's not without his controversies, but that made him what he was, right? Actually, like, a really interesting character in the game, and yeah, we'll put it bluntly, is that the world is worse off without someone like that. So he will be missed, and
it does remind a bit of what Jack and I, because you weren't there for, were you, when we did the podcast after the news about Shane Warne, and Jack and I did a little bit on that, and I've got a sort of similar sort of kind of thoughts about, you know, people generally liked Andrew Symonds because he was a different kind of sportsman. You know, he wasn't the normal guy who seems completely off in a different dimension. Like, he turned up to things drunk sometimes, missed meetings to go fishing. You know, he was he had a bit of character about him, which obviously adds as well to the aura of the man. And he'll be a big miss. And he was a phenomenal guy.
Yeah,
on the pitch.
Yeah, the Fox Cricket managed to do something terrible though. So if you go on to look at Fox Cricket, they've put there's a celebration. Yeah. There's a picture of Shane Warne in the arms of Andrew Symonds, and they've just gone, give them hell. Well, they're now both up in heaven. Give them hell. And you're just like, is the tone really quite right there, lads? Like, come on, that's Fox for you. So Max, let's look ahead to tomorrow's game, which is, well, it's a knockout game. It's as simple as that. Dan Weston's boys, the Punjab Kings versus Delhi Capitals. It's going to be a knife edge, right? Like, Delhi still have the ability to qualify. Punjab Kings also have the ability to qualify, but it's a little bit less. But what do you think we can expect, Max? So, Punjab were really good against RCB. Like, there was probably their best performance that they possibly could have done. Everything kind of went to their plan. But Delhi are also in a positive position.
It was peak Punjab, wasn't it? It was the good side of what we expected this season. We've seen the bad side a few times. We got the good side. It was nice to see Johnny Bairstow finally find his bat. That was good. The noises coming out of it were quite something. And Livingston as well, kicking on. I think was that his fourth 50 in the IPL?
Yeah, he's doing rather well, isn't he? He's doing rather, he's settling in nicely.
He's good, and it was exactly what Punjab are about. And again, it was like they got off to a ridiculously fast start, and they kind of kept the pace up a bit. But you know, they didn't necessarily even have that big finish. It maybe petered out a little bit, but just because of the way they played throughout their batting innings, they'd still put 209, was it, on the board, which is a pretty formidable chase for anyone. And RCB never really looked like they were gonna get there. There was a little bit in the middle, wasn't there, when Maxwell got going, and Patidar had hit a few nice blows as well. But once Maxwell was gone, I think that was probably you got the sense that was the end of it. Yeah. And what's also really big about it though is how big the win was, because RCB's net run rate is pretty bad now, and Punjab's is, well, it's still the worst of the chasing pack. Well, it's not really a pack anymore, is it? It's two of them, but it's kind of rescued it a bit. I don't think if they beat Delhi comfortably, it'll probably switch back over, and then, well, I don't know if it, well, it could switch back over, and then you're looking at a Punjab side that are in a really strong position to qualify, with RCB only having one game left. I think they're in a spot of trouble.
Yeah, I agree, and I think if there was going to be a team who I think, could take this Delhi bowling lineup to the cleaners, I think it's Punjab Kings. I would like to see the Fizz play. If he doesn't play, I think it could be an issue. Like, you need to have that variation, but where they kind of fit him in, not too sure. But I think they need to try and find that balance again, because I think, if the top, if they, any of them get going, like if Bairstow comes out, batters like Bairstow, Shikhar Dhawan's there as kind of the anchor role, Livingston around it, Jitish Sharma to a certain extent as well, it could work out. But if you look at Delhi's batting lineup, again, David Warner in a rich vein of form, Mitch Marsh hitting form at the right time as well, Pant has threatened a couple of times to do bits and bobs and had one or two innings which would be like, that's classic Pant. But again, this is going to come down to who bowls the best and who puts away who puts the rubbish in the bin, as they say. Max, where's your, if you're a betting man, where are you putting your money?
I actually think I'm going to go with Delhi.
Okay.
And my reasons are, actually, I've got a reason this time. I haven't just plumped for a random team. With the likes of Axar and Kuldeep, and maybe even Lalit Yadav, if they want to use him. They've got a fair amount of spin in that side, and Livingston can hit spin. He's not dreadful against it, but he's better against pace. He has come unstuck a little bit against spin this year at times. Rajapaksa, definitely better against pace than spin.
Yep.
He struggles against spin. And they're two guys that they kind of rely on for big runs. So I think we could see if Delhi managed to get a couple of wickets with them, I think they could keep Punjab down to a chaseable score. And yeah, David Warner's back, baby.
Warner's back.
I think it'll be a close one.
I think it'll be a really, really good game. I do think it'll be close. It could well be an IPL classic this one.
I hope it's a close one anyway.
Yeah.
We could do with one.
I'll go Punjab then. I'll back the boys in red and gold.
Western's boys.
And let's hope for a good game. I really like Delhi, actually. The team I think they've got is actually a good side. It's just how they put it together. Prithvi Shaw had typhoid. Things, so he's making a recovery, and he's back in, I think he's in quarantine now, coming back to the camp. So
and that's so unfortunate for Delhi. You can't, I mean, people become unavailable for injuries or whatever, but you can't, like, one of your main guys, your main local guys as well, who's and been in good form, to lose them for so long to something like that is it's really unfortunate. And that's
it's been a bit unlucky for them in general, actually. They've had a couple of COVID outbreaks, a couple of injuries. Obviously their Australian players didn't turn up on time, so it's been a difficult IPL. And actually they're coming out of it with still a good chance of qualifying for the playoffs, and if they do that, I think they could beat anyone on their day. So we'll see what comes out of that, but look forward to watching that tomorrow. Max, I think that's all we've got time for today. So,
I don't think there's any point talking about who's going to win between Mumbai and Sunrisers. I don't care.
There we go. That's a perfect way to finish it. Thank you ever so much for everybody who is who's listened. We really appreciate it. The super chats are incredibly generous, we look forward to seeing how the IPL finishes. Because as Swami's put in the chat, there are so many different permutations actually possible now, so it's going to be nail-biting stuff, I hope, and I hope teams really do put up a fight. We've got massive names who are playing this week, so let's hope we see some brilliance that we can wax lyrical about on Wednesday. Thank you ever so much for watching. Goodbye.